Hello, Turretin fan here. Today I'm dealing with the sixth and final section on middle knowledge and Turretin, dealing with sections 18 through 23 of Turretin's 13th question. This is probably the more complicated, probably the most complicated section of Turretin that we're reading, and I apologize if I get too complicated in my explanation. I'm trying not to do so, but it is a complicated subject. His first philosophical argument, all of these arguments, there are six of them, are philosophical arguments. They're trying to explain the issues in metaphysical terms. His first argument is that God knows the connections that are necessary before his decree as to what will happen, but to know future contingent connections basically requires that those contingent connections not be necessary, and that instead they be contingent on some decree, and consequently it's impossible to have middle knowledge because, as a logical matter, there's no foundation for God to know these contingent decrees, or excuse me, these contingent acts. In other words, in order to know something before the decree, that thing has to be necessary. It has to flow from the nature of things, from the nature of God specifically. But these contingent actions are supposedly not in that category. Therefore, they can't happen before a decree. And, of course, the creature's own decree is not there in existence to serve as a basis. So there's no foundation, and the knowledge just can't exist. The second argument is similar. It says, if all things were connected by necessary connections, knowledge of them before the decree would be possible. In other words, now Turretin's taking a little different tact, saying, well, if they were all connected by necessary connections, then it would be possible for God to know this before the decree, and that would favor middle knowledge. But the problem is, of course, that's contrary to the whole concept of free agency. The whole concept of free agency is that there's determinations made that are free, that are not necessary, that are in some sense contingent. The third point that Turretin makes is that if God sees something as determinate and fixed, he can declare it that way. If he can only see it as possible, he can only declare it as possible. In other words, if God doesn't see these future actions in these hypothetical scenarios as fixed and determinate, he can't have fixed and determinate knowledge of them. He can only have possible knowledge of them. And of course, the possible knowledge of them wouldn't be any use to those who advocate middle knowledge. So we have an unsolvable contradiction there. And he provides an example of what he's talking about here to help try to explain what it is. For example, if the Apostle Peter would possibly sin if placed in a given order of things before the decree, but not determinately, so as to make it true that Peter would actually and in fact sin if placed in such an order of things. In other words, what he's saying is, if Peter would only possibly sin in those circumstances, then God has only possible knowledge of it. In other words, he only knows that it's possible. He doesn't know that it will be such. However, if it will be such, then the only way that it certainly will be such under such circumstances is if there is a permissive decree of God. So let me reread that again. He states, so it is true that Peter would possibly sin if placed in a given order of things antecedently to the decree, but not determinatively, so as to make it true that Peter would actually and in fact sin if placed in such an order of things. This could not be certain unless from a permissive decree of God. So again, the point here is God's permissive decree is necessary in order to say certainly that if Peter were in such and such circumstances, he would sin. So in order for middle knowledge to work, you'd have to have God's permissive decree in there to make sure that that Peter were permitted to act in the way that Peter is alleged to act within this concept of middle knowledge. So you have another irreconcilable contradiction that his act depends on the permissive decree, but supposedly this knowledge comes before the permissive decree. Next, we have the point that necessity and contingency can be used various ways, but something can be either necessary or contingent in one sense, and both necessary and contingent in another sense. In other words, there's more than one relationship that necessity and contingency can have to one another. And necessity can have more than one sense. So there are things that are necessary in the sense that they must be as a matter of logic. And there's things that must be, there's a necessity as to the first cause, which has to do with the fact that God has decreed that such and such will happen. And this necessity as to the first cause does not take away the liberty of free will, because it is not a necessity of coaction, but of consequence or infallibility, which best conspires with liberty. In other words, what Turretin is saying is, yes, there is free will, men are free agents, and yet their actions are infallibly certain in view of this first cause, in view of the first cause which from which all things come. They are necessarily going to happen in a different sense than the difference between, in simple terms, necessity and contingency. The next argument, number 5, is that before the decree, God cannot know what will succeed in moving man's will. In other words, I'm sorry, but the will and will are getting a little bit possibly conflated here, but man has a will. Before the decree, God can't know what will move that man's will. In other words, what will succeed? Well, let's say we have a man who's starving and he's faced with the dilemma of starvation or cannibalism. Well, before the decree to permit the man's actions, God can know that it's possible for the man to go down either way, or God can know that it's certain the man will do one or the other as a matter of necessity. But if it's not a matter of necessity, if it's really a matter of contingency, then God can't know what will happen except if that's founded on his decree that he will permit such to happen. So it is impossible for God to know the future of some future contingent act except based on his own decree that it will be future. And then the last point that Turretin raises is that causing existence is different from causing futurition. And futurition is causing something to be the thing that happens. As Turretin points out, second causes can be involved in causing the existence of things. For example, and Turretin doesn't give this example, but a chicken lays an egg, and a chicken is one of these secondary causes that actually brings about the cause of the egg come forth. God doesn't lay eggs. Chickens lay eggs. But nevertheless, God decreed that. God is causing the futurition of the chicken laying the egg, but that's different. That doesn't exclude, there is no futurition decree from the chicken. In other words, the chicken didn't decree what would be, what will certainly be, although the chicken may have been involved in the creation of the egg. And the reason why the chicken can't have been involved in that is because futurition is something that's determined from all eternity, and even the Molinists agree with this. Now, granted, there are sort of open theists today who would disagree and would argue differently, but Molinists have to agree that God's decree is from eternity, and consequently, the secondary causes can't be involved in the futurition of events. And then, however, the causing of existence happens in time, and therefore secondary causes can be involved in that. And then these sort of loop back up and connect back to the original arguments that preceded them, such that, well, secondary causes can be free causes that do in fact bring about the existence of actions, although those actions are contingent. God knows that they will happen because of his permissive decree that they will. And God knows what will succeed in persuading a man's will because he's decreed that it will. And then, as well, God knows what are necessary. He also knows what things are contingent, but he knows the contingent things through his decrees. And he knows, as well, those things which are future in a fixed and determinate way only after he has made them fixed and determinate. And then, of course, as we had said before, although things have necessary connections in some respects, contingent things have contingent connections, and therefore can't be known prior to those contingencies being removed through a decree of futurition. And then finally, going back to the very beginning, the future contingent connections require a decree. And therefore, for all of these reasons, middle knowledge from a philosophical viewpoint can't exist. And consequently, both on the scriptural grounds we already discussed and on the philosophical grounds, we would reject a concept of middle knowledge and instead hold to the traditional view, which existed before the creation of modernism by the Jesuits, that God's knowledge is divided into free knowledge and natural knowledge with no third category. Thanks for listening. This has been Turretin Fan.